Thank you. Well, thanks once again. So, you see, we have been hearing about thin groups and how interesting and ubiquitous they are. But today, this talk is something like a fine print, you know. Not all the groups that you look at need be thin. Sometimes they could be arithmetic too. And that's what happens here. Of course, I hope you believe me. This being the 1st of April, I don't know, you might not. So, let me recall the kind of groups that we are looking at. So, n greater than or equal to 2, an integer. Actually, necessarily even. F, G are polynomials of degree n, and they are a primitive pair in the sense that primitive, i.e., there does not exist an integer k greater than or equal to 2 such that f of t is some other polynomial evaluated at t to the k, and g of t, this can't happen simultaneously. That's what I mean by primitive. As we saw yesterday, in order that this situation arises from geometry, we have to assume that the roots of these polynomials are roots of unity. So, I am going to assume that too, f, g are products of cyclotomic polynomials. And they are coprime. We are in the what is called the irreducible case. F, g have no common root. Okay, so to this situation, we can associate a certain subgroup of the n by n integral group, namely the group generated by the companion matrices of f. So, let me just recall quickly what it is. X to the n plus n minus 1, x to the n minus 1 plus a naught. So, it is just the matrix of the multiplication by x operator on the free z module. So, it is 0, 1, 0. So, that is the companion matrix of A, and B is similarly defined. So, I take the group generated by these A and B, and because they are products of cyclotomic polynomials, their constant terms are plus minus 1, and so the determinant is also plus minus 1. In other words, this lies in GL and Z. So, if I write the roots as product t minus e to the 2 pi I alpha j and g of t beta k, then this alpha and beta are rational numbers because they are cyclotomic polynomials, and this group is actually the monodromy group of the hypergeometric differential equation. Theta plus beta 1 minus 1 f equal to 0, where f, let me recall, theta was the operator z d by dz. So, a solution to this, for example, if I take beta is one of the betas to be 1, it is just the there is a actual power series which converges. These alphas are called the numerator parameters for the power series, and the betas will be what are called denominator parameters. For n equal to 2, it is exactly the Gauss hypergeometric function. So this is I think it is called some nFn minus 1 type hypergeometric function. So our interest was in this monodromy group, but we are going to confine ourselves to this completely linear algebra situation, because you know, we saw that because of the theorem of Levelt, the monodromy group is completely described by the these matrices. So if you want to test whether something is arithmetic or not, this is the linear algebra question to which you are reduced. Oh, this can't be pulled down. Okay. Oh, thanks. So, actually, given the situation, this monodromy representation is self-dual. Again, it's a consequence of the Levelt theorem. So, I'm going to assume for the moment that f0 equals g0 equal to 1. In which case, if I look at the Zariski closure of gamma, which this will in fact be a symplectic group. Omega, a non-degenerate symplectic form. Yeah. On z to the n. Non-degenerate, by non-degenerate I simply mean that its determinant is non-zero. Excuse me. N is necessarily even with these conditions. Okay, so that's what we are we want to know. The I have a gamma which is a subgroup of the integral symplectic group, and it's a two generated group. When is it of finite index, when is it of infinite index, and so on. So let me state the theorem that restate the theorem that I talked about yesterday. This is a joint with Sandeep Singh. So I look at this polynomial f minus g, which is I write it as a polynomial. It has a certain degree, degree less than or equal to n minus 1 actually. So we will call this the leading coefficient. It is the leading coefficient, sorry. So if c is less than or equal to 2, then gamma is arithmetic. So I want to sketch a proof of this result. The thing is that the monodromy group is more or less generated by unipotent matrices all the time. In this case, if we are in this is what you might call the symplectic case, up to finite index the monodromy is in fact generated by unipotent elements. So let me recall that if I look at, excuse me.
Something special happen when the equality is realized?
When
it's as large as it can be, there's something special happening, particularly nice.
No, I don't know, because you know the way we get it, it's a sufficient condition. It's not a necessary condition. If this, then that. It's not a necessary condition.
No, but still, if C is equal to 2, then...
Yes, it's, you know, the thing is that, the problem is that it's, the proof is sort of abstract. You don't know what the symplectic form looks like. If it is lined up properly, it's a nice symplectic form. Then you can say that it's the entire congruent subgroup of level 2 or something like that. But if it's not lined up like this, then you don't know, you know, it could be pretty bad. Okay, so where was I? Yeah, so let me just recall that if I have this matrices A and B, the reflection subgroup, the group generated a very precise answer, yes and no. I'll come to this. So the normal subgroup generated by this A minus B is called the reflection subgroup. So the let me recall, the issue is whether this has finite index or not. But I have this reflection subgroup which is normal, right? So I have a normal subgroup of this group. If this were arithmetic, then the normal subgroup will have finite index. This is a theorem of Margulis. Yes? So in a higher rank group, maybe I shouldn't take n equal to 2, but higher n. In a higher rank group, a normal subgroup of a lattice is itself a lattice. This was mentioned by Peter the other day. So the issue of whether this is thin or not is equivalent to whether the reflection subgroup is thin or not. Okay, but let's see what this looks like. This A inverse B. So these two matrices B is also like this. One here, minus B naught, minus B 1. So the first n minus 1 columns of these two matrices are the same. And therefore, the matrix A inverse B has the property that it is the same on the first n minus 1 basis vectors. Yeah, because they have the same effect. So it looks like this. It's the normal subgroup. It's the normally generated by one element. And then you see, we have chosen the constant terms to be 1. And so they are in the symplectic group already. That means that the determinants are 1. So the reflection A inverse B actually looks like this. This is what is called a rank 1 unipotent element. And so the question of whether gamma is thin or not, as I said, is equivalent to the question of whether this reflection subgroup is thin or not. And this reflection subgroup by construction is generated by unipotent elements. Okay? So the plan of the proof is that to test arithmeticity, it's not just that it's generated by unipotents, but it's generated by a big load of unipotent elements, a big chunk. Okay, so that's what we want to prove. But before going on to the proof, let me just say it does apply. It gives you lots of arithmetic groups, non-thin groups. Let me first look at the simplest case. You know, I sort of goof up in numbers, so I have to look at my notes. Excuse me. So, example. So, if I take f to be t to the phi minus 1 by t minus 1, this has the property that we want, and g of t to be t to the phi plus 1 by t plus 1, t to the 4 plus t cubed plus t squared plus t plus 1. So f minus g, the leading coefficient is 2, t cubed minus t. T cubed plus t, maybe, sorry. Yeah. So the leading coefficient is 2, so this applies. So the group gamma is arithmetic. So, just to that's the first pair, and if I look at this one, then the leading coefficient is in fact 1 here. Yeah, so one can check this. But in fact, one need not stop here. You get an infinite family of arithmetic hypergeometric groups of symplectic type. So, example 3, t to the n plus 1 minus 1 by t minus 1. If I take this pair, you can easily check that the leading coefficient is 1 in fact. So for every even n is even, so n plus 1 is odd. Yeah, so this is okay. I'm sort of stuck. I don't know why. Yeah. So you see, for every even integer, you have this group which is a symplectic type, monodromy group which is arithmetic. So by the way, this was proved earlier in a very old paper by Acampo. Okay. So let me just explain the connection between this result, and you know, this also follows from this criterion. But in fact, this theorem will give you a new proof of this theorem of Acampo. So we were thinking of monodromy only as the monodromy of differential equations, but in fact, there is a much more geometric way of looking at monodromy. Let me very quickly recall this. So I have, first of all, suppose I have a C infinity fibration of manifolds, C infinity locally trivial. So with fiber F, let us say. So because it's locally trivial, on every trivializing open set, the fibration looks trivial, and so the clutching functions on the two trivializations will give you diffeomorphisms of the fiber. So it, in particular, it gives you an element of the automorphism of the homology group of F with integer coefficients that has to be locally constant. In other words, you get a local system, right? So we get a local system. To such a every local system is obtained by just taking a representation of the fundamental group into the automorphisms of the integral homology of the fiber. So we get a representation rho from pi 1 of the base into GL of the homologies of the fiber with integer coefficients. And I'm going to ignore all torsion for a minute, and I'm assuming that F is nice, so it is a Zn, let us say. So I have a representation of pi 1 of S into GL and Z. So this is called the monodromy representation, and the image is called the monodromy group. But now suppose, in addition, that these spaces are algebraic varieties and that the fibers are smooth projective varieties. X over S is C infinity locally trivial fibration of algebraic varieties. Fiber F smooth projective variety. So at each point I get a smooth projective variety which as a topological space is isomorphic, but as complex structures they are all different. So in this context, again you have the monodromy representation pi 1 of S into GL and Z, and the image was in fact, I mentioned yesterday that the image was conjectured to be an arithmetic group by Griffiths and Schmidt, but in fact counter examples are quickly given to this. As I said, the work of Delin Moster sort of interpreted something that Picard did as giving a counterexample to this conjecture. So where am I going with this? For my base, I take the space of monic polynomials with distinct roots. Of degree n for a fixed degree. So for the fiber, I look at the associated hyperelliptic curve. So this is x comma y comma f, such that y square is f of x, where f varies through here. Okay, and when I say this, I have written the affine part of it, and one has to projectivize. All right, so you have this situation. I don't want to get into the proof of this. The fundamental group here is in fact the braid group. The fundamental group is the braid group, which has a very nice description in terms of generators and relations, where the generators SI are such that if two suffices are quite far apart, they commute. And if they are next to each other, then there is what's called a braiding relation. Okay, and the representation here is also very well understood. So you see that this relations are very close to the relations of the symmetric group. Namely, if I throw in the extra relation that all the SI square are equal to 1, then this is the symmetric group, right? So this is the braid group, and the braid group, the important point for us is that the braid group is 2 generated. It's actually generated, if you just look at these relations, you will see very easily these 2 generate the group. Okay, And so let's call this matrix A and the matrix B. So it's also easy to see, but I can't go into the details now, that the monodromy action on the first homology of the fiber, you know, it's a curve here, so it's only H1 that's involved. The monodromy action on the first homology of the fiber is such that this A inverse B, which is just Sn minus 1, is a complex reflection. So we have two things. We have this A, we have this B, and then A inverse B is a complex reflection. That's exactly the setting in which we were involved in Levelt's theorem. All right, so so if I compute the hypergeometric representation corresponding to that's exactly the representation on the homology. Okay, and therefore you know, the matrices of A and B actually the characteristic polynomials look like this. I don't want to get into too many details. I just want to mention that in this context, using the fact that there are so many braiding relations, Acampo had proved that the monodromy group is arithmetic. So I have to say he uses the theorem of Titz. I looked at the he does use the theorem of Titz. Yeah, I looked at it later. Thanks, that's a good point. Yeah. Okay. Yes, he identified the group to be somewhat between the principal congruent subgroup of level 2 and the whole group. There are sort of certain diagonal things which I've forgotten actually. Yeah. Okay, so this example, so Acampo's theorem can be reproved using this. And yeah, there is one more in this vein. So let me just mention this. So I'm going to take F to be x minus 1 to the 4. And G, again, a fourth degree polynomial, which has no common factor with F. And it's a product of cyclotomic polynomials, has degree 4. And is a product of cyclotomic. So once you are given this, there is not much choice. There are very few choices, in fact. The number of choices is exactly 14. Okay. And here I already mentioned the result of Brown and Thomas yesterday. X minus 1 to the 4 and G is x to the 5 minus 1 by x minus 1. In this case, what they showed was that the corresponding matrices A and B play ping pong, and so this is in fact a free product of Z5 with Z. So this group has non-trivial abelianization, and it's supposed to be a subgroup of SP4Z. If you have a subgroup of SP4Z which has non-trivial abelianization, it cannot be of finite index because this group has property T. So using the same method, they showed that in 7 of these cases, a monodromy is arithmetic. Sorry, is thin. The same proof that the generators play ping pong. And in the remaining 7, let me just take one example. That's a good point. Yes. So let's write it down. x to the 4 minus 4x cubed plus 6x. That's f. And x to the 4 plus x cubed. Yeah, one has to check that if. So if you take the difference, all the coefficients are in fact divisible by 5. You know, because mod 5, it is the same polynomial. So all the coefficients are divisible by 5. So the leading coefficient is at least 5, so it doesn't work. So there is one case where it does work. F is x minus 1 to the 4 and g is x square plus 1 whole square, x square minus x plus 1 the whole square. The coefficient of x cubed is minus 2 here. So minus 4 plus 2 is minus 2, so it's okay. So the coefficient of x cubed here is minus 2, and the coefficient of x cubed here is minus 4, so the difference is 2. So it's exactly in this case that it works. So in the other cases, the coefficient is 3. And so the criterion itself doesn't work, but the proof works. So in 3 of these cases, the proof, we checked by hand that the proof works. 3 are arithmetic. And later, Sandeep checked by some computer calculation that the remaining 4 are also arithmetic. I think I'm writing it too low. Okay.
The reflection subgroup in the Graf-Thomas case is what?
It's sort of fifth powers of something. They're all fifth powers. So if I look at the reflection subgroup here, it looks like, so let's look at the difference of these polynomials. So minus 5 x cubed minus plus 5 x square. So the group looks like this. Up to plus or minus 5. Yeah, something curious happens. So let's call this C. This is a power d to the 5, right? So, but if I look at the group generated not by d to the 5, the normal subgroup generated by d, but not d to the 5, that is finite index. Yeah. In fact, it's the same proof. So, okay, so and what is the big deal about this particular case? Yeah, I have to talk about things that I don't know. So you see, let me first take the Brau-Thomas example. So I could take x1 to the 5 plus x2 to the 5. So this gives me, this is an equation in projective 4 space. So this gives me a curve here. And this is a smooth curve if, zero, infinity, and something else, I don't remember, something related to 5. If I, it's a smooth threefold, excuse me, it's a smooth threefold. Okay, so this is an example of what's called a Calabi-Yau threefold. So you have this family of threefolds. Some constant C naught, which is mapping, right? So you have the representation of the fundamental group on the middle homology of the fiber, And that representation is in fact the hypergeometric representation. Some physicists had computed this, I believe. Yeah. And so the issue was whether that the image of that representation was an arithmetic group, and Brough and Thomas showed that it's not an arithmetic group, it's a thin group. Okay. And this particular family actually apparently is involved in mirror symmetry, and all these 14 examples arise as monodromy of Calabi of three folds fibering over P1 minus 3 points. Okay, so that's the geometric significance of these examples. So therefore, this was open, you know, whether among these 14, which were arithmetic, which were not arithmetic. And it's really sort of 50-50, exactly 7 are arithmetic, exactly 7 are thin. Having said all this, the proof is embarrassingly simple, so I'm spinning it out as much as I can. Yeah.
That will be big.
Yeah.
But you have some unipotent element, but the guy generated is not the full reflected subgroup. Like this, just go through that example again with Brough Thomas. What we have is D.
Yeah. Yeah.
That's the guy you have in your group.
That's true. D to the
group, but not by the full.
Not only by the
Yeah, that's true. That is exactly the point.
Otherwise,
D does not belong to our group.
Right, so you said the thing is to show that the reflected subgroup is
thin.
The full thing, it's always arithmetic. And the problem here is you're only conjugating by the groups, a small group.
I'm confused. Sorry. I mean, if you show that a smaller group is arithmetic, then the bigger one is too. Okay. Yeah, maybe we'll see.
Not just. I think Alex from the Robin asked this. The conjugates of one guy by the full group is always the full reflective group, but not by the small group.
Yeah. Okay. So what is it that goes into the proof? So here is the thing. I'll just state it. I'll prove this in the simplest possible case when n equals 4. That has all the input necessary. So fix three reflections. So this C, A, C, A inverse. Three reflections, all right? So let me make one assumption. In order to fix this particular three reflections, I have to assume that f minus g is let's say c times x cubed plus something times x squared plus something else times x. So the leading coefficient is less than or equal to 2, but the polynomial has degree 3. I can assume this. There are plenty of such polynomials. So I will just take this particular special case. Okay. So let us see what this reflection does. Being a reflection, it is identity on a three-dimensional vector space. So on the four-dimensional vector space, the image of this is one-dimensional, so it is generated by one particular vector. And now we look at the third guy, a squared c a to the minus 2. that looks like this is that W, but it is some unipotent element here. Unipotent. It's unipotent because all of C is unipotent, so all these reflections are unipotent. Now I cannot even claim that this has integral entries with respect to this basis. It has only rational entries. But what is nice is that if I take a big power of a rational matrix, I get an integral matrix. 1 by 99, 0 1 raised to 99 is 1 1 0 1. Yeah. So if I take a power of this, it's an integral matrix. If I take a bigger power of it, it lies in the arithmetic group that I want. So in other words, there is a word. In these three reflections, which is identity on the SL2 part. So there exists a word which belongs to the group generated by C A C A inverse A squared C A to the minus 2, such that its matrix looks like and this stuff is non-zero. That's a computation which one has to make, but it's very easy computation, so it's non-zero. But this was all happening on the three-dimensional vector space, so I choose one extra guy here which is orthogonal to V and AV, but of course not orthogonal to W. It's an extra bit. Okay, so viewed as symplectic matrices, this W looks like some stuff here. Okay. So I have a non-trivial unipotent element here. On the other hand, I also have the group generated by C and AC inverse, which is, you know, this group. So I have these two groups. I have one non-trivial unipotent element. By taking conjugates under this arithmetic group in the Levy part, I get the whole unipotent radical. Okay, so there exists. In fact, let's look. Okay, that W notation was unfortunate. So let me call it a single U. So we have this W which is contained in its orthogonal complement, namely the three-dimensional vector space, and then you have Z to the 4, and all our matrices preserve this flag. And we have got a subgroup of finite index in the unipotent radical of this flag, namely the unipotent radical are those elements which preserve the flag which act trivially on successive quotients. So I have such a unipotent group. So I have this entire unipotent group that let me call this UMZ, which is contained in our monodromy group for some large M. And I know that gamma is Zariski dense. That's because of Beukers and Heckman. So there is a result of Jacques Tietz in this particular case, which says that if you have a Zariski dense subgroup which contains a horospherical lattice subgroup, then it has finite index. and this is true in general too. So let me advertise that. So a theorem: if gamma is a Zariski dense subgroup a Horace spherical subgroup then gamma has finite index. So in this particular case we can get away with just using Titus's theorem. I think that's all the proof. I'm sorry, I have made a lot of mathematicians very hungry, so excuse me.